Rice University, where P's get pedigrees. It's General Physics 1. Today, damped oscillators, and elasticity. Dr. Stenson. Also, a field trip. And now, a man who could really use a sprinkle day. Professor Hafner.
All right, welcome to General Physics 1. I just assume y'all cheer when the class starts at the end of the song. I don't know. Let me know if that's not accurate and I'll get a different sound effect. All right, what are we talking about today? Well, first of all, how did last time go? 68%, all right. We're holding steady in the 60s, all right. So what are we going to talk about today? Today, damped simple harmonic motion. Remember last time, things moving up and down. I'll review it for one board, but nothing is forever, not even the universe. So we gotta think about how is that gonna go away, like the universe. And then we're gonna talk about stress and strain, physical versions of those things. And talk a little bit about the physics of clocks and hedgehogs. Those are not related. We're gonna talk separately about the physics of clocks and hedgehogs. So while you settle in, I'm going to do one little administrative task here and make sure Dr. Stenson can break in on the rare occasion that I make an error. And I like to be able to see the chat. Usually do this earlier. Let's see. All right. And then I don't need to see the Q&A, it's the chat. All right. And speaker, sorry. All right. I usually do this earlier. Okay. So to start, let's review. Let's find my notes, and then we will review simple harmonic motion and how it's going. Okay, so we had simple harmonic, and we never really explained that term. You understand that it's motion, it's something moving up and down. Harmonic just means it's a sinusoidal motion, so it has a frequency, a harmony, and simple means it's just one frequency. So things can move with combinations of sinusoids at different frequencies. Simple means it's just one. So we had two such kinds of things that would do that. We had a mass on a spring in one dimension here, ignoring gravity. Just let it move in X, don't worry about gravity. If you pull it this way and you have an offset in the length because of the weight, we aren't gonna get into it, but I could show you that that just cancels out. And it still oscillates at the square root of k over m. So that constant force doesn't really do anything. So this one, the important thing though, is this moves with a frequency, square root of k over m. And the pendulum is another system that oscillates. Many systems oscillate. And as this thing swings back and forth, we decided that its frequency is the square root of g over l. It doesn't actually care about the mass. All pendulums with the same length will oscillate at the same frequency. That part doesn't matter, or the mass doesn't matter. So if we wanted to write an expression for what does this motion look like, it looks like this. Let's see if here we're describing one-dimensional x motion. Here we're describing, actually it's kind of like angular motion, but we could approximate it as just moving along the x-axis if we wanted to. In some problems, you will have to actually acknowledge that it goes up. Because there'll be some problems where we'll say, let's think about the gravitational potential energy and how it goes higher. And then you have to think a little bit beyond the fact that it's just in 1D and do a little bit of trig, because here is all the way down L. Here it's a little higher. So unfortunately, I didn't draw it high enough. So you say it's there, and there's your right triangle, and this part is still L, and there's your angle. So how high it went is kind of like this L minus this L cosine theta. I think we said something like that in the lecture last time. It shows up on a couple of homework problems. This little, finding this difference is an important little triangle trick. You'll end up having to do a lot. It might sneak onto the exam, I don't know. So you'll see it a few times. If you don't get it, talk to someone. Speaking of talking to someone, I barged in on the remote voluntary homework help session, and there were a bunch of people there talking. So if you're looking for a group, I think I set it for Wednesday at 8 p.m. I just kind of guessed or asked one student, and that's what they said. But y'all can talk amongst yourselves if you want to find another time or an afternoon time. Okay, so let's see. All that said, completely derailed myself. The position along the x or the x we describe it with this, a sine omega t plus phi. And there's three symbols, well, there's five symbols here. It's x, right? So we're finding the position as a function of time, and there's time. We're good with that. Sine is not a symbol, that's the sinusoid function. But it's really the a, the omega, and the phi that are related to all this. So the differences, the distinguishing things, are that omega comes from the properties of the system. All right. So any kind of motion this thing goes through, omega is going to be square root of k over m. Any kind of motion we do here, omega is going to be the square root of g over l. Doesn't matter how it got started or anything like that. These two, a and phi, come from what we call in physics initial abbreviated conditions, abbreviated, which is just, you know, the fancy way of saying how it got started. Where was it at time equals zero? How fast was it going at time equals zero? So we haven't been real formal in showing you how to apply initial conditions. Okay, I went through and we saw for two phases were cases where you like pulled it to the side and released it. And we said, oh, if you use cosine, phase is zero, because cosine has a big amplitude at zero. If you use sine to describe that case, you gotta have pi over two here, because sine wants to be zero at zero, and you released it from zero, you released it from some big amplitude at zero. So sine isn't really the natural one, so it needs a pi over two there. You could also use initial conditions to find a. You sort of do A often intuitively. If I pull this thing to the side by A and let it go, you know it's going to oscillate at A. There's no reason it would get bigger than A. And without damping, there's reason it would smaller than A. But you can also do that with the initial conditions. You could say, well, at time zero, X is zero. You could even say at time zero, V is zero if you want. You could take a derivative of this. And, you know. So there's formal ways to use initial conditions. I'll decide, but for next week's review, if we need to be able to do it formally. But if the whole exam is more like intuitive or like the phase thing I showed you, we may not go through it formally. Okay, but I'll think about that for next week. We have all next week to review. Okay. Hopefully you still got the idea. Okay, initial conditions, property of the system. One question that I got since the last lecture was about this omega. What is it? Is it like our old omega? Is it not? How's the difference the same? So first, I'm going to explain it or show you the demo first. I'm going to show you the demo first. So here's a demo from years ago. No, I think it's 2 years ago. Here we go.
T is that really omega and T are exactly, or I'm sorry, circular motion and harmonic motion are the same thing. Okay, so here you can see the shadow of the little thingy moving up and down. Oh, and over here, you can see the shadow of this moving up and down. And they're both in harmonic motion. See how they're both in harmonic motion? If I really cared, I would make them at the same speed, but there's a limit to how much I care, right? But you can see, you get the feel for what harmonic motion looks like. And look at this harmonic motion up and down like that. Same thing. Okay, so the omega means exactly the same thing. You go through a cycle, which is 2 pi. You can either call that a circle or just a cycle of a period over t. And it's the exact same thing here. Okay, that's not harmonic motion. Oh my God. That's not quite harmonic because it has mass and stuff.
Okay, so There you saw two motions, and maybe you realize they're the same thing. Back when we did circular motion, we've got a mass here going around in a circle. So in that case, it was that aluminum disc and I clamped a clamp on it. We were watching the clamp going around in a circle. So in the old days, you understood what omega was. It was some sort of a rate. It was how fast something goes around, but it's described as in radians per second. And you knew how to get it because you knew that it goes around in the period T. And how many radians is one whole trip around? 2 pi. So 2 pi radians every period. And that was omega. So now the question is, now that we're doing this thing just moving in one dimension up and down, how is that omega? So it's really the same thing. Omega here, it's the rate it does that motion in T, but one trip through the motion is 2 pi. So it's really just sort of like a one-dimensional version of the circle. And in fact, as you just saw, when you watch circular motion like from the side, it is like circular motion. Okay, so they are the same. They're both radians per second. It's just here a radian is a trip around a circle. Here a radian is through a cycle. A circle is a cycle. Really, this is the more general. Any kind of cyclic motion, any kind of thing that's a repeatable pattern, one trip to the pattern is 2 pi radians. Next, let's see. So that is your just a little reminder about harmonic motion and a reminder about omega and a terrifying description that you may need to use initial conditions. We'll clear that up next week. It's one of those things. You could just do it, but if I tell you what you're actually doing, you might panic. You're better just to do it. Okay. So now we're going to get real. Who wants to get real? Oh, wow. All those people want to get real. Good. Okay. There is no case where these oscillations will go on forever. So you just saw in that demo, that circle, that circular motion on the side looked like harmonic motion. But during the time of the demo, it slowed down. The mass on the spring you saw, or this mass on a spring here, if I set it in motion, if I wait long enough, it will stop. Right? This one doesn't last very long at all. Look at that, done. So now we're going to talk about resistive forces and what they do to an oscillator. Resistive forces, basically they oppose motion. But now we're not going to get too real, okay? Because resistive forces are real. Anything real is extremely complicated. So the one you're going to think about, I keep drawing this mass on a surface sliding, kinetic friction, right? That's the one you love. Friction, that's just a constant. If we did a mass sliding on a surface, it depends on the normal force. If the surface is horizontal, even if it's tilted, that normal force isn't going to change. So it's just a constant force. Seems like that would be the easy one to do, right? We'll talk about why it isn't in a minute. Okay. There's another kind of, there's the famous air drag. If you do complicated modeling or equations to figure out how that force depends on speed, the force, this is the symbol for, is proportional to V squared. Okay. So the drag force gets much worse as you go faster and faster. This is why the national speed limit, could you imagine a national speed limit being allowed today? In the 70s and 80s, there was a nationally enforced speed limit of 55 miles an hour. And the reason is, in terms of your energy efficiency of your car, forget your motor and the battery and all that stuff, all irrelevant. How fast the drag force goes as V squared. So when you get above 55, the drag force becomes really significant, okay? So that's why they said, no, we gotta keep everybody down to 55, and then songs came out, I can't draw 55, etc. All because this force goes as V squared. The people writing those songs probably didn't know this, okay? And I've seen this myself. So I was an early adopter of the whole electrical car thing, and I would take trips from Houston to San Antonio, which was just barely, you could barely make it. You had to like stop charge and make it. And it was kind of exciting. It was like the old West. You're going out on a wagon train. I might not make it. I might get stranded and die. So I kind of enjoyed it at that level. But as you watch, your efficiency is really good around low 50s. And as soon as you start going 60 or 70 or 80, you're not going to make it. Okay. That was all fun. So it goes as V squared. Air. What if we do liquid? Then, so the same kind of deal, it's like a fluid creating drag. But if it's a more condensed fluid, like a liquid, not a gas, then the force goes as V. Linear term. All right. And if we want to get technical here, they all oppose motion. So we could say it's negative. Oh, well, no, that one, because it's squared. I can't make it a vector. But anyway, they all oppose motion. I'll just put a negative sign. Like that. They all oppose motion. Okay, so which one are we going to work with mathematically? What do we do in freshman physics? In freshman physics, we do the only one that we can actually solve, which is this one. So we do liquid drag. That is the approximation force is negative velocity or proportional to negative velocity that leads to nice differential equations. And it is relevant in a lot of cases. Okay, so we say our drag force, the only one we consider, is F, oh no, we call it big D, equals minus B, V. Now we're full vector notation here. So that negative tells you that big D is in the opposite direction. And B is the damping constant in kilogram per second. If you just work out the units here, we have a force, kilogram meter per second squared. Let's see, how do we get that? Meters per second, kilogram meter per second squared. Oh yeah, kilograms per second. There it is. Here we go. Yeah. Oh yeah, I even had it worked out for myself there. Okay. So it has no fancy name, just damping constant. This unit has no fancy name. It's not one we talk about a lot, the damping constant, but that's where it is. So now, let's think a little bit about this damping force, like what example of a system are we going to apply it to? So let's think of it this way. We have our famous spring with a mass, spring constant K, mass like that, is all a solid surface, X direction, axis, natural position is there. What we're gonna do is we're gonna put it in a big beaker of water. Like that, it's underwater. There's like a fish, etc. Underwater mass of spring. So now it's gonna have this damping force because it's in liquid. And it's going to be proportional to negative B. But I just want to get in your head a little bit, like just some practice thinking about forces, which way all these forces are. Right now, they're at the natural position. There's no force. You have the natural length of the spring. There's no displacement, so there's no spring force. And if it's not moving, there's no drag force. Right? You got to be moving to have drag force. So let's displace it. So here is like the natural position. Let's put it over here. Pull it that way. Which way is the spring force? Say there's a problem, draw the spring force vector. You'd say, okay, it's that way. Because it always pulls back based on position. Which way is the drag force? Well, I mean, it must be that way, right? It depends on the way it's going. Well, I got so excited I couldn't talk. It depends on which way it's going. Right? Because I didn't say this was the edge and I released it from there. The drag force would be zero in that case, not moving. So we could say it's here, but it's moving out. If it's here and it's moving out, then yeah, the drag force is that way. But what if it's here and it's made it out and it's coming back in? Then spring force is still that way, but now the drag force is that way. Okay, so don't mix up like the spring force depends on the position. It opposes the position. The drag force opposes the velocity. The position of the velocity don't have to be the same direction. Same thing on this side. You know, on this side, the spring force, sure, will always be that way. Right? It's always going to point back to the origin. But if it's moving out, then the drag force will be that way. But if it's moving in, then the drag force would be that way, right? And one reason you need that to be true is, you know, well, I'll say that, that's relevant. So this is the one we can solve. You might say, okay, yeah, that looks hard to solve. But what about kinetic friction? Can't we just, that's constant. Isn't that the same as like when you turn the thing upside down this way and say, okay, the weight is a constant force, it has no effect. So wouldn't kinetic friction also have no effect? Why? It changes direction. Yes, kinetic friction always opposes velocity. So kinetic friction, even though the magnitude is constant, the direction is constantly changing, and not in a way we can simply write equations. Like, it's not, there's not a simple single equation I can write to say constant force with a direction that opposes velocity. I have to use a velocity unit vector, and nobody wants to see that. Okay. So now what we're going to do next, once I erase, is look at the, what are they called? The mathematical solution of this. Here we go, erase time. Now built your intuition for drag forces. Most of those memes are about elasticity, I apologize. So now hopefully you can see it and you can think about it. Think about the force that's causing this to stop. It's friction that's opposing the motion. So actually that's moving too fast to visualize it in your head. Never mind. Okay, let's not worry about that. Let's just stick to the notes. Always a good idea, stick to the notes. Okay, for the simple harmonic motion, I showed you Newton's second law, and we guessed a solution, and I told you don't really have to do that. So this is the same thing. But just for your general edification, let's just go ahead and see what happens when we add the damping force to Newton's second law. And we're just gonna jump to like, the once we've already, once we've massaged it. Okay, it'll look like this. 1D, so just, that's like the acceleration. That was the MA, you know, and we've divided through by an M, so the acceleration by itself. Your damping force was B dx dt, BV. It was negative because it's on the other side. This side becomes positive, and there we divided by mass. And so it looks, the term looks like that. Plus this is what this one looked like last time. Right. Minus kx is Hooke's law, came over here, became positive, we divided it by mass. Because we want this one to have no parameter, because that's just how we do it. I don't need a reason. Okay, so there's your equation. So how do you get this one? You also guess. You look at this and say, what function, if I took two derivatives and then added a constant times one derivative, and then another constant, another times just the function, and I add those up, I get zero. What function? Okay, so it's harder to guess. Take sophomore physics, we do it, or watch hours of online videos. I mean, you know, it's not gonna be on Khan Academy, but it's out there. So you guess, you plug in, etc., and here is the answer. I like to build anticipation. X equals A, that same concept of amplitude, the biggest it's going to get, but now an exponential term, e to the minus b over 2m times t. So properties of the system, its damping parameter, its mass, just a new term, sine, and then the sine part is pretty much the same, omega t plus phi. That's the frequency it goes at, and that phase is whatever you need to make the right thing happen at time equals zero. You know, like for sine, it has no displacement at zero. So sine is really right for if it's sitting at the origin and you hit it and give it an initial velocity, think about it. That means the cosine would be the rep function at zero, which means it has a big value at zero. And that's what the velocity you just did. If you release it from some big amplitude, that's more of like a cosine in the position. And then you would, but if you do it scribe with a sine, you'll need a pi over two. Anyway, repeating the last lecture. That's not the point of this. Let's now look at this and figure out what is going on here. What you can do is you can think of this, the original constant amplitude, e to the minus b over 2mt, as an exponentially decaying amplitude. We'll plot it in a minute. We'll draw it. You'll get good at it. Don't worry. What do we call this? It is just a sinusoid. How bad could that be? It's just a sinusoid with a big but. But omega changes a little bit. Okay, it's not quite the square root of k over m anymore. Omega is the square root of k over m minus b over 2m squared. All right, so damping lowers the frequency a little bit. And I keep saying a little bit because our problems will mostly be what we call light damping. Okay, if an oscillator is undamped, it'll just go at omega naught for a long time. If it's lightly damped, that means this term is really small compared to that term. And it goes pretty much, if you just walked up and said, oh, that's an oscillator, and you would move along. But if you watched it for like 10 minutes, you'd realize it's decay. Okay, so we're talking about cases where this effect is really small. If that effect is really small, this number is really small, and it's basically still going at square root of k over. But it is going like slightly over. Okay. I don't want to cram this drawing right there. Let me draw it nicer. So let's see what this is actually going to look like. And then we'll do a problem with this stuff here. Yeah, let's see. Let's see what it's gonna look like. So if you know your exponential functions, maybe you can be imagining what it's gonna look like. You could attempt to draw it in your notes, diction. If I were gonna draw this, let's see, it's still a function of time. It's still x position as a function of time. I'll just give it a label here. Okay. So you're still just plotting x. But you're basically plotting an oscillator whose amplitude is decaying exponentially. So if you want to make a pretty drawing, it's actually good to do the exponential first. Give yourself a nice little exponential decay like that. That's what the amplitude is going to do. Now, since it's an oscillator, it's going to do that on both sides. Right? It's going to, the positive amplitude, the positive side, the negative side are going to come down the same. Okay? So then you would say, okay, then it oscillates within this amplitude. Like that. So this solid line is the full solution, and this is just the amplitude decay. So this function, the dashed line, is a naught, whatever original amplitude it had, e to the minus b over 2mt, and this is the whole thing, a naught e to the minus b over 2mt sine, this is new omega t plus phi. Okay, so make sure you see the two things were plotted there. Right, so that's a, this is negative a naught, whatever. Yeah, you get the idea. Okay, so the amplitude decays. That's what it does. Can't believe I wasted a whole side of the board on that. Okay, so now I'm going to check the time. I can't see it from here. 908, yeah. So what we'll do is we'll erase this and we'll do the sample problem. And then a couple other things. Yeah, okay. Let me erase real quick. Here we go. Okay. ever driving an electric car cross country, it's a little bit different. Getting stuck in traffic, you won't waste much energy. But if you have a headwind, you're screwed. Because that's essentially increasing your speed, and that damping goes as V squared. So I got down to 8 miles once as I rolled into a hotel that had a church. Okay, just some advice for you. Let's see. Okay, so let's look at exponential decay problems. I'm sure you've seen exponential decay at one point in high school, but you probably never really used it and appreciated it. Decay problems. Or maybe you did. I don't want to judge you. The thing I want to stress is sometimes you don't, my Southern came out there. Sometimes you don't need, I don't apologize for being Southern. I don't know what I meant by that. You don't need the details. So here's an example, right? So I'm going to explain why. We're going to illustrate with an example. Let's have an oscillator with mass 2 grams, 2 kilograms, and damping constant. Constant B is 0.01 kilogram per second. All right. So then, they give you that. Like, okay, that'd be. How long to lose half of its amplitude? And you say, well, I don't even know what the amplitude is. How can I know how long it is to lose half of it? I don't even know. If I knew the amplitude, I would take half of it and plug it in the equation. How hard could that be? But you don't know it. So you got to look at this thing and say, first of all, we just care about the amplitude, not the detailed sinusoid. We don't need omega. We're just asked about the amplitude. So write the equation for the amplitude. A equals A naught E to the minus B over 2mt. Say, okay, well, yeah, I was given B and M, and I know what 2 is, and I know that that's an independent variable. So, but I don't know A. But what you realize is you were given like a fraction, like A based on a fraction. How long does it take to get to 1/2 or to lose half of its amplitude? It means it will go to 1/2 of its amplitude. I picked a half. So the point is, when will it be here? When will it be at 1/2 A naught? And we want the time when that's going to happen. 1/2 A naught equals A naught, E to the minus B over 2m. And then we'll do that thing where we put a star on there. So we're looking for a specific time. So you see, the trick is, if you're ever asked about a fraction of an amplitude, you don't need the amplitude because it's going to cancel. You just get 1/2 equals all that. And if you get that physical insight, then the question is, do you know what to do with exponents? So if you have this exponent here, you need something up there, you take the natural log of both sides. Or if you take the natural log of this, well, you have to take the natural log of that. So the natural log is that one that's ln. I learned to pronounce it lon. I don't know if everybody says lon or not. All right, nobody does, okay. So the natural log of e to the something is just the something. So minus b over 2m t star. You know, we had to say, oh, you screwed up. You're going to get a negative time parallel universe. What does this mean? No, this is not the internet physics. This is real physics. There's a reason that has a negative there. And it's because if you know your natural logs, that's going to be negative. The natural log of 1/2 is negative. I wrote it down. I don't know what it is. No, I didn't write it down. It's like negative 0.7, something like that. Or if that negative sign really bothers you, if you really know your logs, you can invert it and put a negative in front of it. That's what logs also do that, okay? So then you could say minus b over 2m t star, and then go away. So the natural log of 2 then is an invert or the negative version, whatever. Anyway, now you can plug in number, t. And you get t star, in this case, is really long, 277 seconds. And how long that is really just a balance between this, which is in kilograms per second, and this, which is in kilograms. See how those are? Kilograms and kilograms and per second. That's why those two combined gives you a time. And you never knew the stiffness of the spring, right? Independent of that. Interesting. We could go deeper and try to understand why, but I think we've gone deep enough. Okay. You need to know how to use that amplitude. So I think what we'll do is, if we just do one more quick board with interesting formulas, we will be done with this. So let's, unless it's like, oh yeah, no, we're good. Yeah, let's do that. Okay, so that's an example of using the amplitude. Now, let's look at one more thing that you could be asked, required to know. And it's kind of like last time you, we described all this oscillating motion, and then we said, okay, here's what you can do with it. And we put like, you know, double box around the whole board. You can get the momentum, you can get the velocity, you can get the kinetic energy, you can get the potential energy. So we're gonna do that just for one quick quantity here. And also we're gonna introduce a new quantity. Forgot. Yes, okay, so for convenience. Okay, so that means physicists find this convenient. For you, it's highly inconvenient because we're going to introduce another parameter we have to keep up with. So for convenience for me, we define the damping time constant. So before B was the damping constant, the damping time constant, for your convenience, keep in mind, this is all for you. And it is tau equals m over b. Remember a minute ago when I was regaling you with the fact that the mass you were given is kilograms and b were given kilogram per second, and you put those together and you get a time? That's basically, I forgot, I was about to tell you that. So that is the definition of the damping time constant, m over b. What is the point? All it means, you just rewrite the equation in terms of tau instead of m and b. So if you want the amplitude decay, or heck, let's just write all of it. Oh no, it's not, because the frequency gets weird. The amplitude would be a equals a naught e to the minus t over 2 tau. Right, because when we do these position things, it's always b over 2m. Why the 2? Seems like we would have set up the universe of math where there wouldn't be a 2 there. So why is there a 2 there? Well, there's just a 2. Okay, so just deal with it. All right. But let's see, maybe we get some insight, because we also care about how other things decay. Okay, energy decay. Yeah, so remember I told you that physicists, we like to think more in terms of energy. It is a more important thing to us in terms of just the detailed motion, okay? So when we were undamped, what was our total energy? It was E is 1/2 Ka squared, and that was a constant. Now let's think for a second. Why does it look like the spring potential energy, right? That's the spring. You say, wait, if it's 1/2 Ka squared, what about the kinetic part? Remember, this is the total, and that's the biggest displacement you ever get for the spring. So at other times, the potential energy is less than this, and it's moving. But if you add the potential and the kinetic at any time, remember the little sine squared, cosine squared, those cancel out, and you get this. So this is the total energy because it is the potential energy at the moment when you have the biggest deflection and the kinetic is zero. Okay. We could write the total energy in terms of the highest speed at the center of the motion if you want. It would have omega in it though. It's not as pretty. So we usually write it in terms of this spring potential looking term. Okay, so now let's put this in there and see what we get for the damped. So now it's a function of time. The damped energy, 1/2 k, and now we square this. Square a naught. Square e to the minus t over 2 tau. What do you do when you multiply this? You add this to itself, and the 2 goes away. Oh my God. E to the minus t over tau. Okay, so there is the damped energy formula. And you can see now this is why we define tau this way. Okay, so we just care about energy, and there's no 2 in there, it's just t over tau. You know, we could have defined tau with a 2 in it to make this not have a 2, but we don't because energy is the important thing. Okay. So you can solve a problem about how does the damping, how does the energy decay in time, how does the amplitude decay in time? And that's pretty much it for damped oscillator problems. Although there is a big societal, technological thing about what we're talking about here. Let me tell you about it for 1 minute. What are the big discoveries and inventions that have affected human history? Let's start naming them. Fire, right? I'm talking way back. I don't mean like whatever won the Nobel Prize last year. I mean the important ones. Fire, the wheel, agriculture. Can anybody name another one in the chat? Really big ones, changed the course of human history. Somebody will go, sliced bread, no. Printing press, yeah, okay. Paper, internet, not the internet, oh my God. The plow, irrigation, that's my agriculture stuff, metal, steel, transportation, yes. Transportation, the wheel. What's another one? The clock. The ability to precisely track time, incredibly important for the development of technology and commerce and all these other things. So how do we keep up with time? Well, of course, the Egyptians were the smartest with their hourglasses. I don't know, I've seen too many movies. Hourglasses are great, but if you want to get into shorter amounts of precise time, you need a mechanical system that could move a little faster than an hourglass. So, well, these great oscillators. Right? Oscillators back and forth seem like a good way to keep up with time, but they're damped, right? Like I showed you, this oscillator, good correction on your spelling there. This oscillator, I need to track time for more than, 20 seconds. So what do we do? So the big invention in probably late 1700s or 1800s by Huygens, was this, the escapement. So this invention drove technology for hundreds of years because it gave us precise timekeeping. And basically how it's working here is the gray part is just the pendulum going back and forth. And you rely on the fact that the pendulum has a constant omega, basically square root of G over L. Don't care about mass so much, very little damping. So very constant, but you need it to keep going forever, okay? So the gold part is the escapement mechanism, and based on its shape, it gives it a little push one way or the other. So this is the thing with the two big weights. So the escapement has a tension or a torque making it want to turn. So you go to your grandparents' house, well, your great-grandparents' house, they had that old clock, and it's got all this stuff, and it's got these two weights at the bottom. And if you're as old as me, remember your grandparents go, oh, it's time to go, right? Because then it slowly goes down, creating a torque on that escapement. But the escapement doesn't just spin when it wants. It can't spin until the pendulum lets it spin. And when the pendulum frees it, that gives the pendulum a little kick to keep it going. That's also why the spikes on the escapement are asymmetric. They push, it slides up one way and pushes it when it goes the other way. So that is a mechanism where you can use gravitational potential energy to feed the oscillating pendulum, but the system only goes at a frequency defined by the oscillating pendulum. You can push an oscillator and it'll go at whatever frequency you push it. But this is a way to let the oscillator define its own frequency, but put energy into it. So why am I claiming this is as big as fire and the wheel? Is that it also impacted culture in so many ways because this makes a sound like this. Yes, and that sound has such a big impact on us, right? So you think back on this sound, where is this impacted us in culture? Here's some places. Here's Halvin's original clock, the mask of the Red Death, Right, the clock driving people crazy. TikTok from The Wizard of Oz, not the Tin Man, TikTok. Kesha, huge cultural influence. In my opinion, Kesha is a genius. She's too smart for the world. That's why we don't hear from her anymore. And then, of course, TikTok, right? The current thing is called TikTok. It's because of the sound of an escapement made by Howans in like the late 1700s. And it even has a biological, psychological effect. It has been shown that people that hear this sound all the time, maybe in their room, it influences their decision-making on whether or not to have a baby. I'm just saying, it's been shown. So you might, let me just turn that off. And you want to think about whether or not you want to get that kind of an old-timey clock for your room. I would recommend against it. And so our field trip is a little bit related. I have a rant about this pendulum you're about to see. I have like a conspiracy theory about it that is highly accurate, but anyway. Okay, so please make it stop. Yes, I turned it off. Yes, Kesha, I agree. We all agree. I mean, I'll do a survey. I really think she's a genius. Okay, here we go. Okay, so here's the break, and I'll see you in 5 minutes.
Welcome to the Big Pendulum at the Houston Museum of Natural Science, which I strongly recommend if you're ever in Houston. Here it is. It's a very large, massive bob hanging from a very long cable several stories up in the ceiling. The long cable gives it a very slow motion, nice hypnotic back and forth. It's so big, it actually acts as a Foucault pendulum. It's so big that you can sit here and watch the plane of the motion turn as the Earth rotates beneath the pendulum. That's why they set up these little pegs. So throughout the day, the bob knocks the pegs over. And I guarantee you, when a peg gets knocked over, sometimes the room erupts in cheers, but at the very least, one person goes, yes, every time. I'm actually not here to tell you, though, about the Foucault part of the pendulum. I want to think about the pendulum in terms of what we've learned in the class. So when we talked about real oscillators, we realized that most systems aren't as simple as the equations we used to describe them, right? Most oscillators are not linear. For the pendulum, it's linear as long as the amplitude is small. Well, here the amplitude really isn't small. In this case, its amplitude is over a meter. The height, the length of the cable is probably 20 meters. So we're looking at about a 10%. The amplitude is about 10% the length of the cable, which is really not that small of an angle. But we still use the small angle approximation probably if we were going to do a calculation. Another aspect that deviates from reality is that it goes all day. We talked about friction and damping in an oscillator. This thing certainly has damping then. Up in the clamping mechanism, some friction will be generated. Even if you remove that, there's wind resistance for the bob moving back and forth. So it definitely would be damped. It should not go all day, but it does, which means it must be driven. So if up there in the roof, there's something driving it, we learn for a driven amp oscillator, if it's driven at a certain frequency, it'll move at that frequency. Right? There might be a transient, but eventually it moves at the frequency at which it's driven. Well, that means it may not be moving at its natural frequency. It's moving at its drive frequency. Who knows? Actually, no. It's not being driven that way. It's something called a parametric drive. The way it's being driven is that it moves, and when it's at a certain point of the motion, the bottom, it closes a contact and it gets a little magnetic push. And then when it goes through the bottom again, it gets another push. So it's not a continuous sinusoidal drive. It's this drive that depends on the motion itself. And in that case, it does oscillate pretty much at its natural frequency. So as you can see, even something as simple looking as a pendulum, many, many physical things are often going on, but then it approximately behaves as the simple systems we always talk about.
So if you go see that pendulum at that museum, my problem with it is if they have a drive like that, it's hard for me to imagine how that drive would still let it freely rotate with the Earth, like a Foucault pendulum is supposed to do. So when I was making that video, they were showing me different parts of the Foucault pendulum and were taking pictures of it. And at the top, you could get to the mechanism. And I said, oh, I want to see the mechanism of how it drives. And he's like, oh, no, you can't go up there. You can't. I said, no, but you know, it might be cool to show a picture. I could explain to the class. And I started to go to the door, and the person literally went, no, you can't go up there. Okay. So I think museum Foucault pendulums are fake, and they're not really going around with the Earth. It's just a mechanism that makes it do that. And that person didn't want me to out the museum. That person works at Rice now. All right, and I talked to him and said, remember that day when I was looking at that? And he's like, all right. So I think there's an industry of fake Foucault pendulums. It would not be the only fake thing in a science museum, but they still do lots of good stuff. You know, how much of the dinosaur skeletons are really real, etc. Okay. Don't ask questions, just enjoy the museum. Okay, so now we're on to sort of the next level. Because the good news is there's no new physics here. It's just a few equations to describe how objects are deformed. But I'm just telling you it's sort of the next level because we're no longer doing point masses. When we start the class, it's all point mass. Then we get to rotations and we let it have a shape and have an orientation. And we haven't done that yet. We're doing that at the end this time. But now we're even going to let it change shape. We're going to compress it. So that'll be kind of fun. So let's describe deformations of an object. And I'll just let you know, no new physics here, I would say. I mean, there is, but no new physics, just new words, largely. Like there's no fundamental equation of what we're talking about here. So let's take the simplest case of deforming something. Okay, let's take a cylinder, a right cylinder. So a right cylinder means you have a shape and you push it at right angles to its surface. So this is a right circular cylinder. All right, there you go. And let's think of some properties of it. Let's say its length L. It's made of some material, irrelevant for right now. The surface that makes the right circular cylinder is area. See how I drew that like sideways for you? You're not going to get that at, you know, those Ivy League schools. They're not going to draw it sideways. So you got an area like that, and it's just sitting there. There's the geometry. Now what's going to happen is we're going to push with force down. And what happens if it's on a solid surface, right? This can't go anywhere. You're going to compress it. I mean, that's if it's a, I mean, it may be such a small compression you don't even detect it, but real matter is compressible. So you will compress it, even if it's an undetectable amount. And the new height will be like that. So here, I'm exaggerating that greatly. If it's like a normal solid, right? Normally it wouldn't compress that much. But let's call that delta L. Okay, so it has a length, you apply a force, it has some area, and it changes length by delta L. And of course it gets shorter when you apply the force. Okay, so let's look at some of the equations and terms we use to describe this. Apply the force, that's called a force F, that's called the stress. And it's not just force, it's force created area. And you say, isn't that a pressure? And I say, yes, it's like a pressure. Pressure usually refers to a fluid which can apply in any direction on a surface, depending on the direction of the surface. Here we're saying I'm applying an external force by some means to a surface. So, but yes, physically, numerically, unit-wise, it's the same as a pressure. Okay, so you apply a force, which we call the stress, to cause a deformation, delta L, and that deformation we call the strain. strain is fractional unitless number like that. So the stress is like a pressure. The strain has no unit. It's like the percentage that it was compressed, but not in terms of percent. You don't multiply it by 100. It's like the relative compression. All right. So there you go, stress and strain. So the next thing we want to say isn't a fundamental property of the universe. It's just a description of how materials respond to this. You know, does it just collapse immediately and yield delta L? Does it do it as a sinusoid? How does it do it? So let's see. Make it stop. Oh, that's about the clock. Okay. I thought that was the lecture comment. You can keep that to yourself. Okay. So let's plot a stress and strain curve. We're going to say as we apply more stress, how much strain do we get? And you can say, you know, it would have been better. I think of it as applying stress and measuring strain. So we should put stress down here. Well, that's not how we do it. Sorry. It'd also be better to do my fractions the same way in terms of making it pretty. Okay, so we have stress up here and strain down here. And if this upsets you, call the material science department because it's their field that sets it up this way. Okay, so then the question is, how does it go? You know, is it like at first there's no compression and then it gets really big, or is it what? Basically, for any material, it starts as a line. I mean, not any material. Most materials, it starts at least as a line. Okay? Some materials, it's never a line, like rubber. Some materials, it's a line for a long time. And some materials, it's a line for a while and it starts to bend. We'll get more into real materials in a minute. So the property you care about is the slope, right? How much strain do I get for a certain amount of stress? That's a characteristic of the material. So that's equal to the stress under the strain, right? And that's called big Y, which is called the Young's modulus. The Young's modulus. There we go. Okay. Oh, sorry. I never could spell under stress. The stress over the strain, Young's modulus is the slope. This is all a property of the material. So it's one of these things. You just look it up in a table. Look it up, I think, in some of your problems. We usually give it to you, but if we don't give it to you, look it up in a table. Look it up in the table in the book or something. So a property. I meant to add the word. It's an intrinsic. If you're obsessed about intrinsic and extrinsic properties, it doesn't depend on like the diameter of the cylinder or the length or whatever. That all gets into the actual force you apply, the actual strain you get. But this slope is a fundamental property of the material. And I don't have a single one here to show you. And in the problem, I don't have one. So, okay, they're really big. Okay, they're like gigapascal, like 10 to the 9 pascal. So you can see the unit, right? So Y is in what? It's in force per unit area, and this is unitless. So it's in force meter squared is pascal. And for like metals, it's usually like 10 to the 9 pascal. Or GPa, right? Gigapascal. Okay, so the really big numbers. So what are we doing here? So I mean, in terms of simple problems, So we need to write then is the linear, oh no, that's on my next slide. So this is the next point. So there we are. Property of the system, everything's fine. I'll just erase real fast. Oh, but now the means will make sense. Oh, that's okay. So now, We said we have this slope of this line. Okay, so if, here's another thing that'll bother you. If the stress strain curve is a line, okay, so in physics, when we plot something on a plot with two axes, we always call it a curve, even if it's not curved. Okay, so a line is a curve. So then what is it? It's y equals mx. It's the equation of a line. The force per unit area is the slope times delta L over L. So this really is the equation that you use to solve like a lot of the problems. It's like the home equation, the main equation. You could rewrite it a little bit, but let's rewrite and realize what if we said F over here. We have this thing and we're pushing on it up and down. And we want to put F there, and we want to think about the little delta L. Why would we do that? What would end up in here? The modulus times the area over the length. All right, so what does that look like? It kind of looks like Hooke's law for a spring. This is like Hooke's law. So what that means is, the cylinder has spring constant. What? K is Y, the modulus, area over the length. I don't know why I put that in parentheses. Okay. There we go. Box, yeah. So if you're doing a problem, and it's like a mass is being hung from a rod or a thin wire, and you start letting it oscillate up and down, you say, oh my God, how am I gonna learn anything about the oscillation? Well, it's a mass and a spring, and it's K, its spring constant is like that. You're probably given the mass of the thing, and if you need the spring constant, take it like the natural frequency or something, modulus of the material times the cross-sectional area of the wire divided by the length of the wire. And it'll act like a spring in that sense. You could also let it go back and forth. You know, something that's a pendulum and a spring, right? Actually, that's what I tried to do. When I thought about this, there's a little timeout for insight here. Why was I unable? It's like physically impossible to say, remember I said, oh, I want to use a pendulum, but I put a spring on it. Why can't I demo it like that? Like I want to say, okay, let me just treat the spring as a pendulum. Let me just swing it just back and forth. I can. It keeps jumping. Why does it keep jumping? Because it's a spring. Because if you think about the pendulum for a second, sorry to derail you here, the tension is different at these points in the pendulum. And if the tension in the spring changes, that basically means the thing's going to move up and down. So there's your challenge. There's no way you can have a mass and a spring and use it as a pendulum. I'd never realized that until after Tuesday's lecture. You might look at this and say, yeah, it kind of looks like Hooke's law, but where's the negative sign? All right, if you're claiming that that looks like Hooke's law, why is it negative? And it's really just, we're talking about two different things. So if I have a cylinder on the ground and I push on it, we calculated the force of me pushing the cylinder. Me pushing cylinder equals YA over L delta L. Right, but what is Hooke's law? Hooke's law is the force the spring applies to the object, applies to you. Ah, action-reaction pair. Ah, yes, the force that the cylinder applies to me, action reaction, negative YA over L delta L. Okay, so it really does act like a spring in every fundamental sense. It's acting like a spring. Okay, and you can use that in problems. See, yeah, I do have a quick problem we can do here. So let me stop and erase both sides because we're going to need both sides here. What is it? Let's see. Okay. Here we go. Let's just do a quick, throw you some numbers here. A 1 kilogram mass hangs.
Jason?
From, yeah, oh, sorry.
You have your, you had your GIF still up, so it's kind of blocking the chalkboard.
Oh,
yeah.
Sorry.
Or your memes, I mean.
Yes, I was like, I can hear myself. I haven't done that again. A 1 kilogram mass hangs from a diameter equals 1 millimeter length equals 1 meter wire copper. What's the tension? No. What's the extension? So this is, I mean, this is just one step because we can't do multi-complicated problems in real time in class. It takes too long. But let's just make sure you understand where everything would get plugged in. It's force per unit area, or not per unit area, but stress equals Y times delta L over L. So where are we going to get all these numbers? Let's see. The force, oh, it's the, well, hey, let's, well, here it is. It's up here. And free body diagram, mg is down, tension is up. So we'd say, what is the force being applied to the end of that wire? Oh, basically just the weight. The weight is being applied to the end of the wire. Tension is really just a mechanism to describe this interaction. I really should not have done that. Okay, so what force is being applied to the wire, the weight, right? So we say 1 kilogram times 9.8, okay? 1 kilogram plus 9.8. The area it's referring to is the cross-sectional area of the wire. Sectional, yes. So pi r squared. Pi times, in terms of meters, 0.0005 squared, because we've got to convert it to a radius. Right. I need the Young's modulus of copper. So you look it up in a table. Your chapter probably has a table. We give you a value in the exam. We might make you look it up in the homework. 11 times 10 to the 10 Pascal. So I said gigapascal. This one's 110 gigapascal. Yeah. So it's on the, or not 1 gigapascal, but 100 Pascal. 100 gigapascal. So anyway, there's a big number. And delta L over L. What's the extension? We're looking for delta L. And it's a 1 meter wire. So you can see this problem had everything you need for this problem and a constant that you could look up. Right. Turn it around, divide, boop, 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 and you get delta L is 0.113 meters. Okay. So that's like the width of a human hair, depending on what kind of hair you have, but that's generically roughly how wide a hair is. So if we have just a typical, that's really pretty elongated rod, right? 1 millimeter, one wire long, it's an aspect ratio of 1,000. We hang a whole 10 pounds off of it, or 10 newtons off of it, which is 20 pounds, I think. It only extends the width of a human hair. So solids don't really stretch that much, okay? Now, we're going to talk just a little bit. Yeah, we have 10 minutes to think about what happens when you go beyond this elastic limit. And how is that related to hedgerows? That's really, this is what we're all waiting for. I hate to constantly harp on the old days and how awesome demos were, but because that is so small, that deflection is so small, I'll try to find the video of it. We could hang a wire from top of Hersey Amphitheater all the way down with a weight. And because the wire was so thin, it was so long, you could actually feel the extension and you could actually make it vibrate up and down. Maybe we'll just set that up and socially distance, let people come in over the weekend and play with it. There's a huge demand for that, let me know. Of course, I don't want to leave the house, but we'll figure it out. Okay, so all we're going to talk about now is what happens. I mean, in terms of real material, what will eventually happen? I mean, if we keep applying more stress, will we keep generating more strain? No, it'll eventually break. or it will deform. Something bad will happen, okay? So eventually it'll kind of curve over, usually, and then it'll break, okay? Another big question about this is whether or not it'll go back to how it was, right? So you're gonna go back to here, and if you take the strain off, and you go to here, and you take the strain off, it'll keep repeating. The repeating part is called the elastic part, all right? So this part is elastic, as long as you go to there. Stay within that limit and you'll always get your old wire back. But if you go to here, now you've done plastic deformation. You know, we're not gonna write a bunch of problems on this, but I want you to know this because it'll come up later in your life. As you get old, you'll definitely go through some plastic deformation. So if you go all the way to here, it won't come back to there. It'll be like that. Less strain, or more strain, but you stretched it. You basically damaged it, or whatever. It doesn't go back to its original length, okay? So plastic deformation, if you go here, causes all of that. And then there's also the tensile strength. That's when it breaks. All right, so that's here, when the curve is over. So if you want to know what's the maximum stress, is you figure out where does it break, and you just read back along that axis. Right? And that tells you that's the most force created area you can put on this material. They don't all do this nice curve, okay? Sometimes they'll go here and then go that way and then go down and then break. Technically, that's the tensile strength. It depends on what side of the hump you're on, okay? So my point mainly is we're just doing this. A lot of interesting stuff happens when you go beyond here. Also, this curvature doesn't mean it's not elastic. It just means it's not linear. We're just doing things where it's linear. At the beginning, it's linear, it's elastic, everything's fine. It starts to go non-linear, but it's still elastic. And then it starts to go plastic, and then eventually it'll break. Those are kind of the regimes of what happens. This is mostly just for your general knowledge. I think the main thing we will use in the homework and exams is the concept of tensile strength. I'm going to tell you, you know, this material has a tensile strength of so many gigapascals. What's the narrowest wire that can support a certain mass? So you would just say, okay, that's the strain or the stress it can withstand is the tensile strength. Then solve for the rest. Right? So it would look like this. Force per unit area equals Y delta L over L. So you can say, take a certain material and you want to be able to stretch it. I'm sorry. Take a certain material, and you want to know if it can withstand a certain weight, then, well, okay, no, you wouldn't need this sign. If I said, here's, I don't know, I'll write a good problem. There's good problems in the homework. I can't make one up off the top of my head. I'm apparently incapable of doing that. So we have 5 minutes to talk about the physics of hedgehogs here. What does this have to do with hedgehogs? Please make it solid. Oh, again, that's the old. Oh, crap. This is, yeah. Okay, so since there's a lot of bioscience people here, I thought I'd just take a couple of seconds to think about how does this, we've dipped our toe in the real world about how materials really respond. So, how does the biological world make good, strong materials? So one example of that is bones. You know, so like with bones, you've got two kinds of material in a bone. You've got cortical and cancellous. Oh, I'm probably spelling these wrong. Cortical. Oh no, I'm spelling right. And one has a really high strength, and one has a really weak strength. So the question is, how are you going to arrange them? Let's see, which one is high? A cortical is strong. A high Y and a high tensile strength. And cancellous is low Y. And low tensile strength, probably. So how do you arrange them within the bone? You just put them like side by side. What do you do? You would say, well, make it all cortical. I mean, we want to, but that's really heavy, right? It takes a lot of energy to make it. You can have blood vessels flowing through it. So you got to have a mix. So you have a mix. What do you want to do? Well, it depends on what you're doing to the bone. If you're stretching the bone, then it doesn't matter. Because if you stretch and you say, let's make the top C and the bottom C, they're both going to stretch. But what you really care about is bending. So when you bend something, what you really do is you curve it down like this, right? So when you do that, you stretch this side and you compress that side. All right, so we take a solid and curve it down like that. That's what happens. It also does something called shear, but that's much more work, energy to do. So it mostly does this. Stretch the top, compress the bottom. So that's why in bones, you get the strong cortical on the outside and the weak cancellous on the inside, because most of the stretching and compressing happens on the edges. Okay, so I can show you this is true all through biology. So here is, oh, I don't have that. Yeah, but biology does a lot of thinking about where to put materials to redirect forces. So like a hedgehog, so this is like a bunch of hedgehogs. So you ask yourself, what are those quills for, right? One, there you go, they stick in an animal for defense or whatever, but they also protect the hedgehog when it falls. Here's a hedgehog falling from like 10 meters. Oh, it's scary. I hope he's okay. He's eating, foraging, and oh no, and he's fine. So why did the hedgehog just get up and walk away? It's because biology also uses these forces to redirect impacts, impulses, right? So we have all these spines that can turn. So rather than taking the blow directly to the back, the blow gets distributed in all these different angles. It stretches and compresses and spreads over the skin rather than just getting hit right there. So that's one thing the spines do for you. And they're also putting those spines in helmets because your skull, and they're talking about it, your skull is really good at taking a blow like that, like right to the forehead. But you're not good at taking like a torque. Like concussions are when you've torqued your head and your brain like jiggles around due to sideways motion. So they're also investigating, you know, you can put spines on a helmet. And then when you take a blow, it won't give you a torque. It'll distribute that force around the spines. Okay. So by getting into materials with different structures, you can build in different properties. That's the idea. But all you need to know is that part. I just want you to appreciate all the interesting things that biology does with these properties. Okay, there's a little rush there at the end, but I will see you next week for the review. Practice problems, lots of advice next week.
Wake up in the morning feeling like P. Diddy.
Hey, what up, girl?
Grab my glasses, I'm out the door. I'm gonna hit this city.
Let's
before
go.
I leave, brush my teeth with a bottle of Jack. Cause when I leave for the night, I ain't coming back. I'm talking pedicure on our toes. Trying on all our clothes. Boys blowing up our phones. Dropped up and playing our favorite CDs. Pulling up to the parties. Trying to get a little bit tipsy. Don't stop, make it pop. DJ, blow my speakers up tonight. I'ma fight till we see the sunlight. Tick tock on the clock, but the party don't stop. No, don't stop, make it pop. DJ, blow my speakers up tonight. I'ma fight till we see the sunlight. Tick tock on the clock, but the party don't stop. No, like Mick Jagger. I'm talking about everybody getting crunk. Boys try to touch my junk. Gonna smack him if he getting too drunk. Nah, we go until they kick us out. The police shut us down. Police shut us down. Po, shut us down. Don't stop, make it pop. DJ Blue. Downstairs.